Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us here today. I'm Heather Stefanson, the Minister of Health and Seniors Care. With me today, I have Dr. Lynn Stevenson, our external advisor, who conducted the independent review of Maple's long-term care home. She is joining us via video link today. Thank you, Dr. Stevenson, for joining us. We also have Gina Trinidad here today, our Chief Health Operations Officer with the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority. Thank you both for being here today. On October 20th, a COVID-19 outbreak was declared at the Maple's long-term care home. It was declared over on January 12th. In that time, 74 staff and 157 residents tested positive for COVID-19, and there were 56 deaths linked to the outbreak. This was a tragedy for the residents, their families, and for the staff caring for them. I want to extend my deepest condolences to the residents at the Maple's long-term care home and to the families of those who lost their loved ones. I also want to acknowledge the hard work of the staff at the site who were also significantly affected by these events. I can't even begin to imagine the impact of this experience on the families and staff at Maple's. Earlier today, I had the opportunity to speak with some of the families and the staff who were affected by this tragedy. And I want to thank them for making the time to speak with me today. In November 2020, the Manitoba government engaged an expert advisor, Dr. Lynn Stevenson, to review the outbreak at the site and provide feedback and recommendations. Today, we are releasing the full review report, and we are committing to implementing all 17 recommendations outlined by Dr. Stevenson, again, who joins us here today. Now I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Stevenson to go over the review's findings and recommendations. Dr. Stevenson?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Minister. Good morning, or good afternoon, I guess, in Winnipeg to everyone. Like the Minister, I would like to begin by acknowledging how very difficult this has been for families, residents, and staff. As the Minister said, this is a tragic situation, and I extend my deepest sympathies and condolences to those that have lost loved ones. I also want to, though, extend my thanks to all of the people that participated in this review. Their candid, forthright observations and experiences greatly have enriched this report. I know that you're going to be looking for some specific details, and I know that the report has just been released, but this will be at a fairly high level, and it also will talk about the recommendations. So the areas that I was asked to look at were the staffing levels, the preparation and planning for outbreaks, the level of care provided, and importantly, infection prevention and control policies and procedures. So the process that I undertook is I did an extensive comprehensive document review of all of the guidance documents that were put forward, all the directives from Public Health, Shared Health, WRHA, and Rivera. I conducted stakeholder interviews of over 150 individuals, including residents, families, staff, both internal to Maple's, WRHA, provincially, and, for example, the Canadian Red Cross, so those that sit outside. I also did a site visit early December, and I did a review of clinical documentation via reports that were given to me. There are other reviews underway, and one is that you may have heard of was the critical incident review undertaken by WRHA, which is much more at an individual level, and Gina may speak more to that. Now to the findings of the review. It's important when you do a review like this is that you look at what was the circumstances before COVID. And so I looked at what did Maple's used to be like before this happened. And I'm here to say that actually the care was more than reasonable any of the quality metrics that I looked at, including licensing reports, accreditation, quality metrics around falls, medication management, were all very materially met by Maples. They had a wait list for folks to go in there, and even anecdotal comments spoke very highly about Maples. There was an enormous amount of preparation and planning done by both Rivera in terms of their playbook, but also WRHA and the province. There was evidence when I was on site of educational activities that had been undertaken to ensure that the staff were doing their hand hygiene appropriately. They were using proper PPE, personal protective equipment, and that they were actually practicing the donning and doffing of that equipment, which is critical to maintain infection control. One of the areas that was not adequate in all of these documentations was some of the clinical guidance documents, and I'll get into that a little bit further. The pandemic plans, while they were very robust and comprehensive, did not take into consideration what happened at Maples, which was the precipitous and significant loss of staff over a very short window of time. Maples did reach out asking for assistance, and I would say my assessment of that is, although they reached out, the urgency of those asks were not communicated. During the outbreak, having looked at the staffing patterns, there were areas of significant shortages, shifts where there was very, very short staff. The staff of Maples, the leadership in particular, made significant efforts to bring in staff. They were very innovative in some of this. One of the difficulties, however, is that in an outbreak of this magnitude, you actually need staff that have skills. And I'm not entirely talking just about care skills. So some of the augmentation that happened around housekeeping, although it was a very good idea, housekeeping in a COVID situation requires a high level of knowledge and skills, and also a high level of understanding personal protective equipment. So, it's one of those, it was a good idea. Having unskilled folks, I think, is quite difficult. There was not enough infection control presence on site during the outbreak. And one of the things that the families certainly spoke to me about was inconsistent communication. So there's not that there wasn't communication, but it wasn't consistent, and they weren't entirely sure what to expect. So I developed 17 recommendations in the report, and I'm going to go over them briefly. Six were specifically applied to the Maples long-term care home. The first recommendation was to revise their pandemic plan that takes into consideration some of the things that I've already mentioned in terms of skilling up staff when they come in, being very clear about the leadership on site when there's an outbreak, and also the piece about clinical guidelines. As I said, they had a lot of guidelines around prevention control, not as many around if you get into a situation like this, what are the care requirements? What are the vital things that need to be done? And that includes things like pulling back on some of the non-vital medications so that staff are very clear where they should be focusing. The third recommendation was to Rivera is that when they have an outbreak, they need to deploy additional resources from Rivera on site at the beginning of an outbreak and until stabilization. And those can be in the form of extra leadership positions, extra physician support, but there needs to be more people there that are actually part of the outbreak. The fourth recommendation is to ensure that regular on-site physician rounds occur immediately once an outbreak has occurred. There was a bit of a delay in that, and I think that physician on-site would have actually helped the staff set some of those care priorities. The fifth recommendation tracks back to what I said about housekeeping, is that housekeeping is a critical essential service. It is not something you can just learn to do. And so enhancing housekeeping during something like this is vitally important, and making sure they're properly educated in terms of enhancing cleaning activities. The sixth recommendation goes back to what I mentioned about communication, the notion of consistent communication with families and being clear with families what they can expect, how often they can expect to hear from the facility, and what type of information can they expect to have. two recommendations apply at the regional level. Again, ask them and strongly suggest they revise their pandemic plan so that there are adequate supports for personal care homes. Because in the case of Maples, with so many staff going off, they needed additional help from WRHA on site. The other part around that is the communication and decision-making, roles between the tables. You have provincial planning, you have local planning, and then you have regional planning. So one of the strong suggestions was to streamline that planning so that everybody knows who's responsible for what. And in the case of personal care homes, they know who to go to. And I know some of that work has actually also happened. The purchase service agreement that exists between WRHA and Maples and the other care homes also, I suggest, it needs to be looked at with more of a focus on a situation like this in terms of what are the care expectations during an outbreak. In terms of the incident command, we talked about simplifying that. We also also recommended that there's a coordination of materials. So again, a lot of work went into directives, a lot of work went into guidance documents. If you're a small facility and you have just a certain amount of bandwidth, it's hard to keep track of all of those. And I think when planning is done in different subsets, sometimes the coordination doesn't occur as you would want it to. The one strong recommendation to Manitoba Health and seniors was to have a province-wide healthcare system response to pandemic. So what happens, for example, in Brandon should actually have a similar response to what happened at the Maples, and that it's a Manitoba-wide response, because these outbreaks, as you've seen in your own province, can just take off. Then I made six general recommendations that fall a little bit outside the scope of the Maples review, but certainly fit very much into seniors care. So the first one is to ensure that long-term care is an integral part of the continuum of care. So it sits, my observation is it sits a little bit outside of the rest of the planning. And so it needs to be part of the planning because it is integral to acute care services, home and community services. That there be a clear system for deployment of infection prevention and control clinical resources. They are at a high premium in this entire country. So to actually focus on where best to apply those, particularly in an outbreak situation, has to be done across the system. It can't be done facility by facility. The next one talks to the workforce. We've talked already about the staffing issues. I understand that there's been some good work done on a robust personal care home workforce plan. And I guess my strong suggestion is not only to continue that work, but to implement the work that's happened. Part of the, I think, plight of long-term care through COVID that we've all learned in this country is funding. So I'm strongly suggesting reviewing a funding for personal care homes in Manitoba to ensure that they actually are meeting the needs of this increasingly complex and vulnerable population. Licensing has a very strong role in personal care homes. And again, my observation and recommendation is to review and streamline some of those standards to make sure that the care standards are front and center. The last two recommendations speak to restoring the trust with families. Certainly, I heard very clearly from many families that their trust had been eroded at Maples. And I think that the staff there are working very hard to restore that trust. And likewise, I needed to mention the enormous toll this has also had on staff. They have worked not only enormously hard from a physical point of view, but emotionally it's been very difficult. Unlike in hospitals, in residential care, these are their families. They care for these people. So they have experienced enormous loss, and I know there's work underway to actually help them move through this to a better future, but I cannot underestimate the toll it's taken on individuals. So now, Minister, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Stevenson. And I want all Manitobans to know that we take these recommendations very seriously. And we did not wait for the final report in order to start taking action in these areas. Work has already begun on many of the recommendations at the site and at the regional level as well. Efforts have already been made by Health Incident Command to improve the pandemic response. This includes changing how the planning and operations tables connect to each other and to the long-term care sector as part of the province's overall pandemic response. Work has been done to further strengthen infection prevention and control practices. New measures have been implemented to promote safe visitation by designated caregivers and visitors. This includes updating visitation guidelines, mandating the same protective personal equipment for designated caregivers and staff, and implementing outdoor and indoor visitation shelters to support safe family interactions with residents. We also implemented an asymptomatic personal care home staff surveillance rapid response, rapid testing pilot project, which has now been completed. And we have seen some positive outcomes from this project, and we'll have more to say in the coming days with respect to that. Work has also been done to develop new staffing strategies, including looking at opportunities to redeploy community and continuing care resources to support staffing stabilization in sites with high needs due to the outbreaks. So despite efforts that have already been taken, we of course recognize that there is still more work that needs to be done, and we're committed to implementing all recommendations within this report. I've directed the department to assemble an implementation team. This team will put together a plan to implement all 17 of Dr. Stevenson's recommendations. That plan will be released publicly within 30 days, and the team will provide status updates every 90 days also, which will be public as well, be made public as well. The implementation team will also inform ongoing work to modernize and expand the continuum of care for seniors, including home care, supportive housing, and supports for personal care homes. This work is key to ensuring a range of supports are available for seniors when and where they are needed. This includes looking at options such as enhanced supports for caregivers, expanding self and family managed care options, and building supportive housing capacity as well. Some of this work is already underway as part of Manitoba Health's modernization and Manitoba's clinical and preventive services plan. As plans are finalized, we will be able to share more of the details with respect to those areas. We also know that there is work to do to upgrade our personal care home facilities to provide better care for residents. Many facilities are older, and some still have multiple residents in the same room. This has been an ongoing problem for decades and has become even more apparent during the COVID-19 pandemic. That's why our government is calling on the federal government to take action to support some of our most vulnerable citizens, especially now after the COVID-19 pandemic has led to tragedies like the one that occurred at Maples in the long-term care facilities across the country. Their support is needed in the long-term care and to ensure seniors have access to the quality services that they need, want, and deserve. We want the federal government to work with us to increase funding under the Canada Health Transfer and develop long-term funding agreements to support seniors' care across the province. I want to in particular thank Dr. Stevenson for her time, her hard work, and her insights into how we can do better as we move forward together. We will work with our regional partners to implement these recommendations, and we will continue to build stronger, safer supports for seniors across the continuum of care. Once again, I want to extend my heartfelt condolences to the residents, the families, and the staff of the Maples Long-Term Care Home, as well as many thanks to all those who made invaluable contributions to Dr. Stevenson's report. And now, before we open the line for questions, I'm going to turn it over to Gina Trinidad, Chief Health Operations Officer at the WRHA, to make a few comments. Gina?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, Dr. Stevenson. Good afternoon. I'd like to begin by sharing with families of personal care home residents, particularly those who have lost loved ones to COVID-19, just how deeply and sincerely myself and all healthcare employees within our long-term care sector have grieved the loss of personal care home residents who contracted the virus. To all of you, we are deeply sorry for your loss. Staff at personal care homes, including redeployed staff, continue every day to step up and tirelessly ensure the care and safety of residents despite this unprecedented and difficult situation. They have been understandably tired and worried at times, yet they continue to persevere, and we would like to extend our sincere gratitude for all of their efforts. I also want to thank the Minister, Dr. Stevenson, for all their work and support to help us investigate the situation at Maples with the goal of helping us, staff members and family members, understand what happened. It is important to note that we did not wait on the outcome of Dr. Stevenson's report to take action. From the night of November 6th, we were on site at Maples, identifying and implementing actions immediately, reinforcing not only existing site resources, but the resources and supports available to all personal care homes. Staff and management teams in Winnipeg's personal care homes and long-term care facilities and the leadership of our long-term care program continue every single day to consider best practices and implement measures according to clinical experts and established protocols. We are employing every feasible tool at our disposal to ensure outbreaks can be mitigated and controlled to the best of everyone's ability, and have continuously and diligently do so to date. One of the key actions was to place WRHA clinical leads in Winnipeg personal care homes with the greatest need to provide that on-site, real-time oversight, the guidance and support. These site leads work with management at all personal care home facilities in an outbreak situation to provide oversight and guidance. Any issues or concerns are communicated to the WRHA's long-term care program leadership regarding concerns or questions around resident care, staffing resources, infection prevention and control practices, and family communication. The WRHA clinical leads are now all assisting personal care homes with vaccine clinics and post-outbreak recovery planning. An important action was to redeploy many WRHA staff members to assist personal care homes with their urgent staffing needs, largely from the community health services sector and also from our acute care sector. We have filled more than 2,000 personal care home shifts in this manner over the past few months. We also worked to establish a central staffing model for personal care homes. This strategy has improved staffing supports, particularly on the evenings and nights and weekends. Working with the provincial recruitment and redeployment team, we have deployed uncertified healthcare aides, both those enrolled in the new Red River College training program and those not requiring the training, such as those who are internationally trained or students in health sciences faculties, to support the staffing needs in personal care homes. We have also moved to make WRHA's community intravenous program team available to personal care homes to provide resident hydration, and have provided close to 600 hydrations on site across Winnipeg personal care homes. Our palliative care teams, our regional infection prevention and control staff, and respiratory therapy specialists have also been made available to personal care homes. We have worked also very closely with the Canadian Red Cross to arrange for infection prevention and control assessments and support around that effort. We've also been working with the Red Cross around support aid deployment to several personal care homes in the Winnipeg region. We ensured that there was regular physician coverage and medical monitoring of all residents, coverage which continues to be provided on site and virtually at our priority sites. daily situational huddles with the management teams of all personal care homes and the WRHA long-term care program leadership have been established to share information, progress, and challenges in real time. These calls continue on a regular basis. Long-term care has also had a voice at the provincial planning and incident command tables to raise issues and concerns directly from operators and for those issues to be addressed in a timely way. In closing, to those who have lost loved ones to COVID-19 at Winnipeg Personal Care Homes, I want you to know that while we can't imagine how devastating this pandemic has been for you and your families, we are your fellow community members. We share with you a prolonged and genuine sense of anguish and pain. Moreover, and I say this to everyone, as healthcare workers, we are entirely committed to learn from the extraordinary situation experienced through this pandemic and at Maples to ensure we can improve the level of care and safety as we move forward.
Thanks very much, Gina, and I think we're open for questions now.
Thank you, Minister. A reminder to our reporters on the line, you will have one preliminary and one follow-up question. Up first this afternoon from the Winnipeg Sun, Josh.
Good afternoon. This is Josh Aldridge from the Winnipeg Sun. With the level of outrage that was in the public and in Manitoba and Winnipeg regarding the situation, I think a lot of people were looking for some level of repercussions going back to Rivera, whether it comes to licensing fines. There's a number of ways people could look at it. Is there going to be any kind of repercussions for the operator or for the care coming out of the situation?
Yeah, thanks, Josh, for that. Great question. And I think, you know, certainly this has been a tragic situation for so many families who have lost their loved ones. And I know that there has been, you know, obviously a heightened awareness of the situation across our province and indeed across the country. What we have here today is a report with the recommendations by Dr. Lynn Stevenson, 17 recommendations. A few of those are attributed to Rivera as well, and we will work with them in a collaborative way to ensure that those recommendations are implemented. We want to ensure, first and foremost, the safety of those residents who are in the facilities, not just in Rivera facilities, but in personal care homes all across our province. And we want to ensure the safety of the residents as well as the staff. So we'll continue to work with our stakeholders to ensure that that takes place and that these recommendations are implemented.
Now, the recommendation about funding, it's not just Manitoba, it's across the country where there's been not really great increases in funding for personal care homes. Does the province plan to put more money into personal care homes, long-term care facilities, or is the plan just to rely on the federal government to increase health transfers to fund seniors' homes? Does the province have any plans on that end?
Yeah, first of all, Josh, another great question. And first of all, I've asked the department to establish an implementation team that will put together a plan. I've asked for that plan to be completed within 30 days, and we'll go from there. And part of that will be funding. I did mention in my opening remarks today that we want to ensure that we work with the federal government. This has to be an all of governments and an all of country approach, frankly, to the situation that we're in. And so we'll continue to work collaboratively with other levels of government and those in the communities to ensure that we have the proper long-term care facilities that are needed for those residences, that they're safe for both themselves and the staff who work there.
From CBC Manitoba, Bart.
Hi there. In this, I guess this one is for Dr. Stevenson. In the summary of the report, it states that the urgency of requests for additional on-site staffing support were not fully understood until the situation became critical. Who did not fully understand it? Baird Health, the WRHA?
Thank you for the question. I think it was, and it goes back to, I think, my comments about the incident command, the number of what, planning tables that were around there. I think that there also wasn't a level of specificity about asking for staff and responding to staff. And I think to Gina's comment, that's something that's been corrected. So I think I wasn't there, but what I understand is asks were put out and people got the asks. They began to action it. I don't think they actioned it in as timely a way, which goes back to my comment about not understanding the urgency of it. I'm not sure if that answers your question.
To some degree, I'll get a little bit more specific here. You just said in your comments that Rivera reached out for help during the outbreak. Yes. Can you elaborate on that? What help was asked for? From who? What's your understanding as to why support was not deployed before things got into a crisis situation?
Sure. Thank you. And so, without, you know, trying to waffle around it, I don't know why their support was not given until it became urgent. All I can do is go back onto the documentation where staffing was asked for, but it wasn't asked for, like, if we don't get it in 5 minutes, we're going to have a problem. That's what I mean about the urgency. It was almost like a pro forma ask. Plus, there were asks in many different areas. So, for example, the staffing agencies were asked for staff. I think WRH was asked for staff. I think the incident command was asked for staff. All of that sort of piles on, and all of a sudden it becomes urgent. I think that's the other point that I also need to make, is it's not as if the staffing, you know, over time got shorter. This was fairly precipitous. As once you do the testing, and once people test positive or have to await their test, they have to go off. So you have more than two or three, you have 10, 15 people going off at one time, and then trying to replace that staff. And they did not have the mechanisms in place that Gina just described at 5 or 10 minutes ago about redeployment immediately. So that's part of the lesson.
Thanks for that. Thank you for that.
From the Canadian Press, Kelly.
Hello, thank you for your time. We obviously just received the report, so it's difficult to go through 74 pages right now. So can you give us a little bit more detail, going off Bart's question, of when it was known by Rivera that staffing levels were critical, and then when that was actually communicated to other agencies in a way that would provide more staffing levels?
Sure. And Gina may want to jump in on this because she would have been the recipient of some of the information. So in your report, you'll see a timeline, and in your report, you will see the staffing patterns. And as I mentioned in the last response, is the staffing is fine, and then it is immediately not fine. And I know that's hard for people to grasp, but that's, if you look at the major outbreaks in this country, that's exactly what the phenomena has been, is the precipitous, significant loss of staff. And so I believe that WRHA and the incident command were being highlighted to them there were going to be staffing problems. What I don't know is what was understood around those staffing problems and when they became urgent, because they become urgent very quickly. And I think that's one of the things we've learned in this country, is that it becomes urgent without a whole lot of warning.
I'm not sure if Gina's going to come in with an answer as well.
Yeah, so certainly when we look at the situation at Maples at the beginning of their outbreak, and then as they progressed during that outbreak, there were certainly internal on-site type of resources that they tried to activate within their own control. Things like, you know, accessing agencies, using general workers. They've at one point also had security guards that they also trained. So there were mechanisms internally within the site that they did activate. Provincially and regionally, we did not have the staffing pool that we do have now, and shortly after that the situation at Maples, and we've worked very hard with our union partners to be able to, again, as I said earlier, redeploy staff from other areas in the health sector, whether that might be community health services or acute care services, to fill some of those staffing needs within personal care homes who are struggling with staffing. So we did not have that that mechanism at that time when Maple's, their situation escalated and their resources. We have that mechanism now, and we will continue to have that mechanism as long as personal care homes have the needs for staffing ongoing. And we're also going to be prepared in the event that, a situation like this happens again or a potential other wave to be able to have that mechanism trigger very quickly to respond to staffing needs in personal care homes.
And once again, it might be in the report, I haven't had time to look. Did the report find any kind of justification for how Rivera provided WRHA with the wrong numbers about staffing prior and during the last minute press conference that we had a few months ago when this became public due to a Reddit post?
So it's Lynn, I can't respond to that. I wasn't aware that wrong numbers have been given around that. So I'm sorry, it's not part of the report, if that's what you're asking.
From CTV Winnipeg, Josh.
Hi, Dr. Stevenson. Josh Crabb from CTV Winnipeg. The report makes mention of an unannounced visit November 2nd, which I think we previously knew about. So 4 days before the multiple ambulances had to be dispatched to the care home. Now, we also know from briefing notes that were obtained through a FIPA that the WRHA said that just 4 days before this incident, staffing was fine. Did your report look into that sort of discrepancy at all? Like just 4 days before this incident, it seems like everything was fine. Where's how does that get explained?
Yeah. Thanks, Josh. I don't explain how that discrepancy gets. What I explain is what was found on the November the 2nd in terms of that, and then the sequence of events after that. So I would say to you that the report that I read from November 2nd began to foreshadow there was going to be staffing issues. And I've certainly seen the report, I've seen the response from WRHA, and then I think this gets into the discrepancy of interpretation of that. When I looked at it, I only looked at those documents and didn't get into what people thought of them. So to me, looking, because if you're looking, you see things. I would have said that November the 2nd unannounced the foreshadowed there were going to be staffing issues. I'm not sure that it foreshadowed it was going to be these critical staffing issues.
Okay, and it sounds like from Ms. Trinidad's comments that the WRHA may not have even been able to provide staff to help had it been flagged earlier. So I'm wondering, Minister Stefanson, then Dr. Stevenson's report flagged several issues with pandemic planning. How much accountability does your government take for what happened here?
Yeah, no, good point. And I think what we need to do is move forward here. I want to thank Dr. Stevenson for her report. We are committed to implementing the 17 recommendations within the report. The implementation team will come up with a plan within 30 days, and we will ensure that all of those recommendations are implemented.
From City News, Mark.
Hi there. Just trying to maybe understand some of the things that were said here for the audience. I know when we got into the explanations of the review, we said care was more than reasonable, quality metrics were met. Later, a paramedic described it as a nightmare scenario, and here we called it a tragedy. I'm just like, how do we make sense of that juxtaposition to the audience trying to follow this?
Sure. Maybe, Minister, I'll take that so my comments about the quality metrics was to look at Maple's before COVID, before an outbreak, because the impression that I had, frankly, reading some of the media report, is it really wasn't a good place to begin with. That would not have been my findings. So to level set, before this happened, the quality metrics that I would expect to see in a personal care were all materially met by Maple's. Then we move into what happened then during the outbreak. And those are two separate things, but it's important for you folks to understand that before this, it would not have been a care home that people would have said, is terrible or the care is bad. And I certainly had that very much validated by the families that I talk to. So does that clear it up a bit?
Yeah, thank you. I guess then for the families that you did talk to as well, who maybe did lose somebody during the outbreak and put their trust in this personal care home to take care of their loved one, do you feel that everything was done the way it needed to be for them, or were they failed in some sense?
Well, I think the minister has responded to that. I think what the report says and what the minister said and Gina said is that this would not be the way they wanted things to roll out. So I would say that there were things that could have been done better, and the report is very clear about that, which is why my understanding, Minister, is that all the recommendations have already been started, and Gina has mentioned that, and are going to be worked on. So maybe I'll turn it over to you, Minister.
Yeah, absolutely. And I will just say as well that it was very important for me as a fairly new minister here to have an opportunity to share these recommendations with the families this morning. So I did meet with the families. We did meet with the staff as well. It was very important that that they heard from Dr. Stevenson about what the recommendations are. I just want to thank them for taking the time to meet with me today. It was very important that we had that opportunity. And as we continue to go forward, we will commit to, again, we will put a plan in place. The implementation team will put a plan in place, and we'll ensure that that the all 17 recommendations will be implemented.
From the Winnipeg Free Press, Danielle.
Hi, good afternoon. Dr. Stevenson, my first question is for you. So you spoke a little bit in your introductory comments about a recommendation to streamline planning so that all the relevant government groups know who is responsible for what and when. So I'm wondering if you found that delay by the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority to make an on-site visit to Maples and to provide direct oversight on its operations, you know, early in this COVID outbreak, led to excess infections and deaths among residents?
Great question. I wouldn't have an answer to that. I think part of the trajectory of this disease is that, you know, on November the 6th, when, you know, the paramedics, you have to back that up almost 14 days. So 14 days before that, when people were first becoming infected, you didn't see this precipitous loss of staffing. So a lot of this comes down to staffing. Would it have been helpful to have had more people on site? Yes, it likely would have been. Would that have prevented, I think what you're getting at, the deaths? I can't say. I think part of the review of the deaths is part of what I understand, Gina, is the critical incident review. And I believe they will actually be looking at that on a more detailed level. I didn't look at it from that level of detail.
Gina, do you maybe want to comment on that as well?
Sure. So we do have our critical incident review that is being led by our quality and patient safety team within the WRHA, who is reviewing every single death that occurred at personal care homes, including Maples. And we are going through that particular review right now and reaching out and connecting with families to share our findings around that. The critical incident review process is privileged and confidential under legislation. So we will certainly be continuing to work with families and reach out with them to share the specific findings related to their loved ones' care through that process.
Okay, thank you. And Minister Stefanson, I'd like to follow up on Josh's question. Does your government accept any responsibility for the tragedy that has occurred at Maple's personal care home and to ensure the care home operators had the resources that they needed to be able to look after the residents with COVID-19 and, you know, appropriately manage this outbreak at the outset?
Yeah, again, I had the opportunity to meet with the families this morning, and certainly what they have gone through is absolutely tragic, and we have certainly apologized to them for what has transpired. I think what's very important here is that we learn from mistakes that are made and how we can make things better and safer for both the residents as well as the staff who work in those homes. And so, again, we're committed to ensuring that all of those 17 recommendations will be implemented.
From Global News, Brittany.
Good afternoon, Brittany from Global News. I guess, Mr. Stephenson, this is likely for you. What is the timeline and the cost to implement all 17 of these recommendations?
Yeah, good question, Brittany. As I mentioned, the implementation team will put together a plan. We're expecting that back within 30 days. Then from there, we'll see what the recommendation is in terms of the time frame to be able to implement these. You know, some of these are shorter term, which we've already heard today that some of these recommendations have already been started to be implemented. Of course, we'll continue to report back to the public every 90 days as to how we're progressing with respect to implementing all of the 17 recommendations.
Thank you. My next question would likely be for each of you. We had heard about critical staffing levels or understaffing at Maples at the time of this, but when actually digging deeper into this, was there anything that came out that was very surprising to each of you throughout this recommendation and this report?
I don't know if we want to, Lynn, do you want to start or?
No, actually, I don't, I'm pausing a bit because sadly, I don't think there was anything surprising in this. I think the circumstances are always different in all care homes. I do think it points to, and I think the minister's already talked about it, is the need to have a system-wide oversight to all of this so that all parts of the system respond when there's a crisis like this. And I think that's a learning, again, in the country around how you respond to things like this. And then I think the other piece that surprises some folks is how fast this can take off. It is a little bit like a bushfire. Once it starts going, it really grabs hold. And I think that's another really important lesson, but not entirely surprising.
Yeah, to Lynn's point, for me, I think there was nothing really surprising around the recommendations from Dr. Stevenson's report. Again, it's also the quickness of how things escalated and how quickly within, you know, certainly it can be hours, and what we've experienced in terms of our monitoring, our work with the personal care homes during their outbreak phase, how quickly things can change from a staffing, resident care situation, and how, you know, the need to quickly adapt and to address issues as they come up very quickly.
Yeah, thanks to you both for your comments there. And I would just like to add that these are obviously unprecedented times, it's not something that is unique to one personal care home here in Manitoba. This is something that is being faced across the country. I think what's important moving forward is that we learn from some of the challenges. We now have this report where we can take the necessary actions to ensure the safety of the residents within the personal care homes, not just at Maples, but in all personal care homes across the province of Manitoba. And so that's why we will commit to implementing these recommendations so that will provide the safety of all residences in personal care homes right across the province, as well as the staff who look after them.
From the Brandon Sun, Michelle.
Good afternoon. I'm curious, Dr. Stevenson, and I haven't had the chance to really go deeply into your report thus far, but Rivera also operates a personal care home in Blandon. Did you do any comparative looks, you know, like if they're operating one in Blandon and nothing happened there, like is there a lesson to learn there at all? Or
Actually, that is an excellent question. And what you will find in your report is a couple of pages that talks about the sizes of personal care homes and specifically what has happened in some of them in Manitoba. But your point is, has there been a comparison done between Rivera in Brandon, for example, and Rivera? So that was not part of the mandate of this, but I would suggest to you that there is a whole body of work that's now being undertaken across the country to actually try to ascertain why is it. So what I've got here is, so for example, the Poseidon Personal Care Home, and you've got to keep in mind, I'm not that familiar with Manitoba, had a positive rate of 9.2%, and another one had a positive rate of 23%. So your question is, so why is that? And I don't think that we actually fully understand that at all.
Okay, thank you. That's actually the only question I had. Thanks so much.
Our final reporter this afternoon from CJOB, Will.
Yeah, hi, good afternoon, everybody. First question for Dr. Stevenson or the minister, I suppose. What are your metrics for success going to be here? I'm looking at the recommendations, and some I think are just a check mark, yes, no, did this happen? But others are a little more ambiguous, like improving communication, that sort of thing. How is the public and the families going to know that these recommendations have been met?
Yeah, maybe I'll kick it off here, Dr. Stevenson, and if you wanted to add anything, please feel free to do so. I think what's important here is that we have these recommendations. We will develop a plan. I've got an implementation team putting that together now. We'll have that plan within 30 days. And I think it's critical that moving forward that we will be as open and transparent as we possibly can throughout this process. So that plan will be made public in 30 days, as well as we will continue to have regular reporting that will be available to the public, whether it's 60 days, 90 days at a time. I'll wait for the recommendation of the implementation team as to what that will look like. But certainly we are committed to ensuring that the public is kept aware and that there is an open and transparent process.
Okay, thank you. Final question for Dr. Stevenson. In what capacity were the families involved in your review? I know you mentioned there were some questions about the level of communication between them and Maples, but was there any other sort of input?
Yes, actually. So I had three telefocus groups, and I talked to, I think it was 38 families over three consecutive focus groups. And the discussion went something like, what was Maples like before COVID? And that goes back to the quality metrics. What were you, was your understanding through the first phase of COVID, and then what happened during the outbreak? And that's where the recommendation about inconsistency in communication. So there wasn't a unified voice on whether it was good or not good, whether the staffing was okay or not okay. Keeping in mind, during the outbreak, 90% of these families were not allowed to visit. So a lot of their perceptions and experiences of what they read in the newspaper or when they could get a hold of people. So going back to the last question about what I think is a metric around communication would be right back to the families. So what is reasonable communication during a situation like this? So they were very involved. And when you read the report, certainly I've tried to reflect, because what I would do at the end of these sessions is summarize what I heard from them. So you'll see that there isn't consensus on a great deal of this, but certainly there was. And one family said to the minister this morning that they felt that the communication had been very good through the whole thing and was back to being very good. That is not, though, everybody's experience.
Thanks, everyone. This concludes our media briefing.